Ham Radio Now, episode 105. AMSAT's Fox-1 CubeSat. The missing episode. What's that all about? All right, I admit it. I'm Gary Pierce, KN4AQ. And way back last year, 2012, I was down at the TAPR Digital Communications Conference in Atlanta, and I recorded all the talks, and I put them all online, or at least I thought I did. Well, it turns out that one of the fellows who gave the talk, the fellow that gave the banquet talk, Bdale Garbee, KB0G, that's Bdale there. Well, he also gave another talk, a talk about AMSAT's Fox-1 satellite, the CubeSat that is coming up. And somehow I never edited and put that talk online. And at this year's DCC, 2013, the one out in Seattle, the one that the Kickstarter sent me out to, a guy named Tim Shepard, KD1KY, asked me about that talk. He thought it should have been on there. He was waiting for me to put it on. He was asking if, you know, I was going to get around to it. And, well, to tell you the truth, I missed it. Let me take a look at the conference schedule. And sure enough, there it is. AMSAT Fox-1 update, Bdale Garbee, KB0G. And then we took a look at the Ham Radio Now episode list from all of those episodes. And this is really a mess. I need to do a better job of at least isolating the TAPR stuff. And we looked through it, and sure enough, nothing on the Fox-1 talk. It should have gone right here, after episode 34. And before, episode 35? Should have been episode 35. Because it came right after Steve Bible's talk on the ARRLSAT. So I missed it, and I'm going to put it on now. Something I need to tell you about. Bdale will talk about the date for the launch, which back in 2012 was scheduled for right about now, in November 2013. And that's been pushed back another year. It's currently scheduled for next fall, sometime in fall 2014. And it'll be interesting because Bdale will talk about how he was going to be really rushed to get everything ready between the time of the DCC and what he thought was going to be a launch coming up in just a year. So he's got a little bit more breathing room now. Something else I want to point out is that he'll also talk about AMSAT's Vice President of Engineering, I think it is, Tony Montero, AA2TX, if I got that right. Yeah. And I did another interview. This one was at this year's Dayton Hamvention with Tony and his buddy Mark Harmon, N8MH. And they were also talking about AMSAT's Fox-1 satellite. And they had some more updated information on that. That's about the time when they announced the new date that's going to be in 2014 for the actual launch. The two talks have a lot of overlap, a lot of similar information, but Bdale's is more technical. He's got a lot more background information on the actual design and construction of the satellite. So it's worth watching this one. It's worth watching both. So if you're an AMSAT guy, if you're interested in the satellites, this is your first chance to see Bdale's talk, unless you were at the DCC. And if somehow you missed Tony and Mark, well, then go back and take a look at episode 85 and watch theirs, and you'll get a double dose of AMSAT's Fox-1 satellite. And I apologize for missing that. The 2012 episodes were not covered by the Kickstarter, so just in case you're interested in helping out and haven't done it yet, Ham Radio Now is supported by you, by volunteer viewer contributions. Arvin is sitting back there overseeing the fundraising for Ham Radio Now. So stop by our website, hamradionow.tv, and click on Arvin, and you get a chance to make a contribution to help us keep Ham Radio Now going with all these really wonderful programs. Beginning to sound a little bit like Bob Heil. One more thing I want to mention is episode 104 has received a lot of reaction, I kind of expected it to be. It's the one on preppers, ham radio, and preppers. I can't think of two episodes that might have totally divergent audiences. This one and the episode 104 on preppers. But this is a show. It's not a symposium. So I'm not going to talk about that right now. I will stick some comments about that at the end of this program. So if you're here for AMSAT, we're going to go right down to way back at 2012 at the DCC and listen to Bdale Garbee. And then if you're interested in the other stuff, stick around for the end of the show, and I'll have some comments to make about the prepper episode. So now, back to 2012. Sherman, set the Wayback Machine back to 2012. And Atlanta, Georgia, and the TAPR Digital Communications Conference. And Bdale Garbee talking about the upcoming AMSAT Fox-1 CubeSat.
All right, continuing on our talks this Friday morning, I'd like to introduce Bdale Garbee, KB0G. Bdale's been very active on the AMSAT Fox project, and he's here this morning to give us an update on AMSAT's activity with the Fox CubeSats. Bdale?
Hello, can you hear me okay? Somebody nod or smile or, okay, great. So good morning, thanks very much. By the way, I was very excited to see how many hands there were of people who haven't been to a DCC before. I've actually been to lots of them, but not so many recently. So I'd like to thank John and Steve and the other folks for inviting me to be here this weekend. Those of you who are planning to be at the dinner tomorrow night will be subjected to me again, I gather. But when the sort of call went out to find out if someone from the Fox team would be willing to come and talk about what we're doing with the Fox satellite program and AMSAT, everybody sort of looked around and said, well, gee, isn't Bdale going to be there anyway? Can't he give you that talk? And I said, yeah, sure, as long as somebody else creates some slides. So I must thank Tony Monteiro, the VP of Engineering from AMSAT, for handing me a slide deck that he put together, which I've hacked on just a little bit because I can't leave anything well enough alone. But credit where credit's due. I don't tend to make slides that look this pretty unless they're just photos of things. Out of curiosity, how many of you are AMSAT members? Oh, that's really cool. How many of you are Fox team members? Yeah, there are a couple in the back of the room. Good to see you guys. Hopefully we'll get a chance to do some chatting while we're here. I'm really appreciative to Steve, too, for letting me go second this morning for two reasons. One, I think it's thematically appropriate to talk about where AMSAT's trying to go next after talking about something that AMSAT's already worked on, which was the AeroSat things. And secondly, I'm a night owl, and I don't treat mornings very well. They don't treat me very well. And I'm two time zones east of normal. So this has been particularly tough already this morning. If I do sort of doze off or start rambling uncontrollably, feel free to throw things. Okay, so let me give you a little bit of background. How many of you actually worked Oscar Echo, AO51? A few of you? This was, I think, in terms of the total number of users, at least in North America, the most popular satellite that AMSAT North America has ever been involved in. And I think that probably had something to do with the fact that it was really very easy to use. At least in the modern era, there are a lot more folks with HTs and handheld style antennas than there are people with large VHF, UHF ground stations. Though it is amusing, when I took the AeroSat survey myself, my son and I had actually listened using a phase 3 AMSAT class ground station with really long Yagis. It meant that we had to get up on the tower and replace the elevation rotor because it had been not working since we had good high orbit satellites a while back. But it was an excuse to go out and freshen things up, and we had a really good time with it, but there just aren't that many of that class of station around anymore. So I think this is part of the reason that this was such a successful satellite. Unfortunately, it did fail in late 2011, and it's just not there anymore. So AMSAT in general, and certainly the AMSAT North America board in particular, I think feels very intensely the need to have a replacement for Oscar 51 In large part because without an active satellite that lots of people are able to use and enjoy using, the number of people willing to pay for AMSAT memberships, not surprisingly, starts to tail off, and that makes it really hard to do future projects. The problem is that the launch costs for a satellite of the physical scale of ECHO are just astronomical these days. You know, one time in history we had the opportunity to launch a satellite that was about 600 kilograms, Oscar 40. I don't personally expect that to ever happen again. The convergence of opportunities and circumstances that made that possible are just very, very unlikely to recur. And the number of launch vehicles that are being invented today is so much smaller than it used to be that the number of opportunities to get rides as the replacement for ballast on test flights and so forth is much lower than it used to be. And even beyond that, the launch vehicles that are going up taking commercial payloads that are having test flights are actually managing to sell the payload capacity on the test flights. You know, the risk's a little bit higher, but you know, so much more has been learned and people are so much better at being successful launching things that the risk isn't what it used to be, and the motivation for letting folks like us have free rides or really cheap rides just isn't what it once was. I guess in that sense, we're really victims of our own success. We showed the launch vehicle industry the notion that you could use the unused space around a primary payload to stick secondary, even tertiary payloads. And now, you know, they get to charge really big money to put really small things in orbit, and we just can't afford to play. So what does that lead us to? Well, it means that we have to find some other more reasonably economical approach to trying to build a replacement. So that's where Fox comes in. How many of you have heard of the whole CubeSat thing? A lot of you. Okay, I'm not terribly surprised because it seems like everybody and their brother, at least all the universities that you run into, are building CubeSats. CubeSats are interesting because they're 4-inch cubes. That's really quite small, right? And as a consequence, they don't have a lot of mass, they don't take a lot of volume, and we're to the point now where sort of every launch vehicle that goes almost anywhere that's got some excess capacity from a delta V standpoint, it tends to have one of the P-pod launchers bolted onto it, and there are lots and lots of CubeSat launch opportunities. Sadly, most of them are to pretty lame orbits. Actually, it's probably a good thing because given how many people are building CubeSats who've never built a satellite before, and what the resulting success rate is of those satellites once they reach orbit, the fact that they're in relatively low, what we like to refer to as self-cleaning orbits, is maybe a good thing. But there's a lot of really interesting work being done by the various projects that are doing CubeSats. And not everybody building CubeSats are a bunch of undergraduates who've never touched this stuff before. There are some really high-powered teams in various places around the U.S. and, in fact, in other parts of the world who are developing some really innovative technology to go there. So, why don't we do this too? And in particular, why don't we try to apply the same level of engineering expertise and the same sort of approach to failure management and so forth that we've used in designing prior very successful amateur satellites and see if we can't squeeze an ECHO class satellite's worth of functionality into a 4-inch cube. So that's the challenge that we've set ourselves. Now, in order to actually be successful at launching one of these, it does require money. And frankly, it requires more money than we're having an easy time obtaining just through donations. It still boggles my mind that the worldwide AMSAT community was able to raise as much money as we did to fund the launch of Oscar 40. Even though that was a substantially discounted launch, collectively around the world, we still placed a whole lot more than $1 million in hard cash on the table to get that satellite launched. Today, we just can't do that. There isn't that much money sort of left in the ecosystem that we feed from. So one of the things that's happening with Fox-2, which ties in very well with the whole motivation for educational outreach in the ham radio world in general and in AMSAT in particular, is we're partnering with universities for various science and education missions that can be coupled together with the communications payloads that we'd like to fly in a way that makes us attractive to the people who are willing to fund various launch opportunities. And so the goal really is to sort of get people like the NASA Alana program excited about some of the science that can be done with the satellites we'd like to build. And then we kind of get to take advantage of the rest of the on-orbit life of the satellite and the rest of the time that's available to do ham radio communications things. And everybody in the end ends up winning a little bit. Schools that otherwise might be trying to cobble together an interesting science experiment with a satellite bus being designed by people who've never done it before instead get the opportunity to, you know, couple their experiment with a bus that frankly we think will have a higher probability of success, and we get, you know, access to some launch opportunities. So the whole Fox program, we started off with this grandiose vision of, gee, you know, let's put the whole kitchen sink 2 into the first CubeSat. And very quickly, you know, that devolved into a, no, we can't really do it that way. Part of the reason is that a CubeSat has, at best, a power budget on the order of 2 watts. Let that sink in for a second, 2 watts. And we'd really like a lot of that power to go into the transmitter downlink so that this is as easy to use as something like Oscar 51 was. So what does that leave us with? Well, this notion that, you know, if we're successful at starting and running a, you know, Fox program, then gee, maybe we'll be able to do more than one of these. So let's think of this in terms of phases. So sort of the most important thing to the AMSAT North America board and to many of the members right now is to replace Oscar 51. So for the Fox Phase 1 satellites, of which we hope there will eventually be more than one, but right now we're talking about building one of them, we're going to go with a single CubeSat, the sort of the 1U size, if you will, about 4 by 4 inches. It'll have an FM analog transponder on it, right, with UHF up and VHF down, and sort of optionally, it'll have a 9600 baud digital data link. It's actually a little bit more sophisticated than that. We couldn't help ourselves, and I'll explain that a little bit more in a minute. But the basic idea is a really simple AO51 class, you know, repeater in space kind of satellite. And if we were successful at putting one of those together, it would actually be a substantial technical accomplishment, because we'd be taking stuff that used to fit in something like a 9-inch cube and shoving it down into something that fits in like a 4-inch cube, and we'd be dealing with a smaller power budget. And there's just all sorts of things that would be you know, really significant about doing that. And then if we're successful with that, and if we're able to, you know, continue this mode of working with universities and other people to be attractive to the folks who fund launches, for research and so forth, we would then move on and do some phase two satellites. And in this case, as far as I'm concerned, the payload gets a whole lot more interesting. We'd love to be doing more software-defined transponder kind of things, play with a mixture of linear and higher speed digital modes, you know, probably, you know, still providing capabilities that the majority of AMSAT members would have some way of interacting with. But, you know, we might go bigger. There's all kinds of things we can, should, and could do if we had sort of a steady stream of interesting university relationships and associated launch opportunities. So for the Fox-1 program, this is the satellite. Fox-1 is the satellite that's currently being developed. And we're working with a group at Penn State that has done a really interesting MEMS gyro experiment. MEMS, of course, are the micro electronic machine sensor things. You know, one of the most substantial drivers in recent memory on advances in MEMS technology is the fact that the accelerometers used for firing airbags in cars are MEMS devices, and that's caused a lot of manufacturers to see a high enough volume of parts to be willing to invest in driving the fab technology forward. But there are all kinds of cool parts that are available now. And, you know, for example, in some of the high-powered model rocketry stuff I'm doing, which I'll have some photos of tomorrow night, in parts that are, you know, like 5 or 6 millimeters square and 1 millimeter or 2 thick, we're getting 3-axis gyros and 3-axis accelerometers for cowling them out, and all of that in very high quality for, you know, like $12 a part. And this is just kind of amazing. The problem is that those parts really aren't very good for doing on-orbit attitude and motion determination. And the reason is that the spin rates of a satellite like this are actually really slow. And so you need parts that not only are good at, you know, detecting the fast motion, but have a low enough noise floor that you can actually successfully detect and measure really low rates of rotation. So this is a surprisingly interesting experiment, even though MEMS parts today are pretty common stuff. One of the things it means is we can't use any of the cool digital interfaced MEMS part because they're all too noisy. There are, however, some interesting two-axis gyros that have analog outputs that have a much lower noise floor and are amenable to the right kind of filtering to make, we hope, it possible to successfully and repeatably measure satellite orientation and rotation information. But that really is an experiment. It's going to be very interesting to see how that works out. The really exciting part is that the combination of the communications payload that we've described and that experiment allowed us to win one of the slots in a NASA ALANA program. And that means that, yes, we will have a launch. And yes, it will be paid for by somebody else. And with any luck, that'll be happening sometime in the second half of 2013, which in amateur satellite terms is really exciting, really cool, and oh my God, it's coming really soon. You know, second half of 2013, believe me, as the one of the folks trying to design and build that, that's kind of a crunch schedule. We're excited about it, though. Okay, so from an operational standpoint, in order to keep things sort of really simple, and in order to have the highest probability of a successful operational lifetime for the satellite, we've kind of broken the objective into two pieces. One of them is this sort of transponder mode, and this is the default mode that we expect the satellite to come up in, where it's basically acting as a repeater in the sky with this extra little trick that slow speed data from this MEMS experiment will be sort of continuously transmitted at a low data rate with a sub-audible digital encoding in the transponder downlink. What that means is you'll be able to fire up a free telemetry gathering program, open source, you know, all the right magic words, that will allow you, by feeding audio into the sound card on your PC or whatever, to sit there monitoring the telemetry from the satellite, including basic health and welfare, and gathering data from this MEMS experiment, even while people are having conversations through the voice transponder. Pretty cool. It's a neat trick. It's not all that technically complicated to do this. I noticed Phil wandered in and is sitting in the back of the room. It's, you know, the right modulation encoding scheme. You can do this. It doesn't have a significant impact on the normal FM users of the passman. And if we get it right, this will be really cool. But there's also a mode that we'll be able to command the satellite into where we have the ability to interact with the processor on board with higher data rate. This is not needed for us to believe that the Fox-1 satellite mission has been a success, but it's the kind of stuff we'd love to have a chance to test out some with an eye towards the future. One of the things that's happening, however, is that there are questions about the part that we're using for the processor on the housekeeping unit here and what its actual on-orbit in the radiation environment life will be. There's just a lot of things we don't know about the modern generation of chips, even after having the chance to run some of them under various radiation sources. And so one of the keys here is that the logic that controls the switching between these modes is all really dumb and done in discrete transistor logic and absolutely guarantees that we'll fall back into transponder mode if something goofus happens with the processor. So the goal here is, in effect, you know, what we were describing for a while is zombie mode, the notion that even if the main processor on the satellite croaks, that the transponder would be able to continue to operate, the battery charge management would continue to operate in some kind of at least a minimal mode, and we'd have a long, useful service life of the communications part of the satellite, even if we don't have an incredibly long life for the MEMS experiment and the associated digital stuff. Of course, you know, I'd love for it to all work forever, but it doesn't always work that way. So this, you know, this is the block diagram of the satellite. It's been a long time since I was able to draw a block diagram this simple for an amateur satellite and actually have it mean something, but that really is sort of, you know, as much as there is there. And we've been prototyping things, and there's been a lot of progress towards real working hardware. Nobody yet has actually built what, you know, I would consider anything like flight-ready hardware, though we're on the cusp of doing that for a number of the subsystems in the satellite. One of the things that's really important when you're dealing with a satellite this small and a total power budget this small is you really want to eke as much energy as possible out of the solar cells. So there's been quite a bit of work being done on maximum power point trackers for the solar cells to try and ensure that we eke as much energy as we can out. And by the way, to get to something like a 2-watt power budget, we are using just about the best solar cells money can buy. That is one of the more substantial expenses associated with this program, is the power generating subsystem, even though it consists of only about a dozen solar cells, a couple for each face of the cube. There's also been quite a bit of work going on various parts of the RF subsystem. I guess if John's here, you know, you can ask him all sorts of questions about that later. But again, the issue is that you need something that's very robust and also reasonably efficient, because you'd like to get as many sort of watts of power into the downlink as possible out of that relatively low power budget. I'm not the best person to talk about what's happening here, but I'm very encouraged by the reports I've seen, and certainly everything I've looked at in the design of their board looks completely plausible and credible to me. The Penn State student team that did the work on the MEMS experiment actually did deliver a approximately the right size circuit board. It has its own processor, which was smart because it allowed them to actually run the sensors and collect some data and so forth well in advance of our having any of the rest of the satellite's hardware together. But as often happens with students, these kids have all graduated and gone on to other things. So one of the things that we've decided to do is actually to not have this be a separate circuit board, because at the end of the day, what the processor on this board was actually doing is just reading analog voltages off of the four outputs from the two-axis sensors and doing a small amount of filtering math. And it turns out we've got way more than enough processing power in the ARM chip that we're using for the main central processor on the housekeeping unit to just do that. And for the first time in a really long time, the processor circuit board that I'm designing for the satellite is not real estate constrained. I've got great gobs of spare printed circuit board area available, which, when you see tomorrow night some of the things I've been working on over the last few years, is an incredible luxury. So I foolishly said, yeah, sure, we'll put the sensors on the IHU and just integrate that. So this is really cool. It's real hardware. It actually works. to the best of my knowledge, you know, all the stuff that we would like to have work out of this, you know, has been demonstrated to work and should work once we move the sensor portions of the circuitry, which is this part down here, and shove that over onto one corner of the IHU processor board for the next generation. And speaking of the IHU, it's really simple. It's basically, right now, it's got sort of one big chip, a couple of little chips, and a whole bunch of really low-scale integration transistor switches and solid-state relay things. We're using a chip that my partner Keith Packard and I have been using for some of our high-power rocketry stuff that's fairly amazing. STMicro makes this thing called the STM32L151. The STM32L series can actually execute instructions off of the 32 kilohertz secondary clock with power consumption levels as low as 9 microwatts. Now, we're not going to run it that way because we actually need more processing power than that, but the low power modes on this are really amazing. We get a real 32-bit ARM Cortex M3 implementation that's fun to write code for and easy to do sophisticated processing on, that consumes less power than your typical PIC or AVR. And by the way, the chip's cheaper. One of the reasons we switched over to use them on some of our rocket stuff is that chip is actually cheaper than any AVR that I can buy, you know, with a reasonable pin count for reasonable amounts of I/O. It's, you know, capable of running an ARM Cortex M3 style instruction set at 32 megahertz, all sort of software scalable clock division stuff, 128K of flash, 16K of RAM, none of which, by the way, has any error detection and correction associated with it. That's part of the challenge with this is, yeah, you know, this is not your father's AMSAT processor board. It's going to be interesting to see how all this pans out actually in orbit. And all of the analog I/O on the chip is 12-bit, which is really quite good. There's a cute little 4-pin, it's actually 2 pins plus ground and reset debugging interface that ST came up with that works brilliantly We've got excellent support in the GCC cross-compiler tool chain. We can write code. We can do source debugging on the target over this little four-wire interface. It's really great. And it has an integrated USB interface, which makes no difference at all in orbit. But on ground, for the software developers and for all of the work that will be done before the satellite's fully stacked, that's an excellent pre-launch interface. It's actually much cleaner, and it will be much nicer to work with than some of the kludgy ground support interfaces we've been forced to build in the past. As I mentioned, you know, in order to ensure that this satellite has an excellent on-orbit lifetime, even though we don't really know how long a processor like this will last in orbit, we have a very robust watchdog and power control design implemented in discrete transistor logic. Let me tell you, it's a lot of fun, you know, playing around. It's been a long time since I did that many transistors to do that much state machine. And it's actually not all that many at the end of the day, but still, you know, it's been a long time since I had a chance to do that, and it's been a lot of fun. There's some analog buffers so that we can take the analog input and output interfaces on this chip and use those to do software-defined radio things, feeding data in analog form to the RF board to do that sub-audible carrier for the downlink, and when we're switched into the command mode to do 9600 baud kinds of data. This board would be capable of handling a software-defined radio uplink, but there are currently no operational needs for that, and so I don't know that we'll ever actually implement the code to do that. One of the interesting things about the Fox satellite in an AMSAT satellite kind of history compared to a lot of the things I've worked on, you know, all the way back to Oscar 16, is that we don't plan to upload additional firmware to the satellite after launch. We intend to have all the code, all of which is, you know, reasonably simple, completely operational before launch and just let it sit there and work. Again, we'll see how that plays out, but it's all part of the plan to keep this as simple and as functional as possible. We're going to use a part I've never used before, which is an FRAM. This is a type of serial interface non-volatile storage that actually uses sort of ferroresonant technology and is supposed to be very radiation hard. As I say, I don't have a whole lot of personal experience with it. The beauty for me is that it interfaces a lot like most other serial interface memory chips. Comes in a cute little 8-pin package. You stick it out and down on the board, hang it off a spy bus, and hopefully it will just work. As I already mentioned, we're going to integrate the Penn State experiment, which is a couple of MEMS, two-axis gyro parts. It's interesting, we can't actually get a three-axis part that has this really low noise analog output mode associated with it. All of the three-axis parts are digitally interfaced and intended for, you know, more consumer-oriented uses, like knowing which way your iPad's tilted or something like that. And as a consequence, we actually end up using two of the parts. Fortunately, they build a couple of variants of them, one of which has, you know, a Z-axis and the other one does, you know, X and Y. I forget, I guess it's the X-axis that we'll be doubled up on, but by using two of the two-axis parts and taking advantage of the type of surface mount chip that they are and taking advantage of the automatic component alignment that happens when you get the footprint right and the reflow soldering works the way it's supposed to, we expect to have a very well-aligned three-axis sensor at the end of the day. There was already some mention about the software that was used for ARRLsat-1. Very similar approach being taken for the Fox telemetry software. Open source, a Qt-style interface based in part on some of the statistics that you saw from Steve's presentation. The intent is to, out the door, make sure this is available for sort of all versions that are relevant of Windows at the time. But because it's open source and using Qt, which is reasonably good cross-platform stuff, I certainly hope we'll do a Linux build because then I can use it too. And you know, maybe somebody in the Mac world will help out as well. This is kind of what the guts of the satellite are going to look like. And yes, that's a big stack of circuit boards all fitting inside sort of a 4-inch cube. We're using some Samtec. Whoops, I did it again, wrong button. We're using some Samtec stacking connectors that are surface mount and something like 60 pins, if I remember correctly. They're in my schematic, and now I don't worry about how many pins they are. I just hook up to them. but the idea is that we have this sort of stacking bus that's the main wiring backplane of the spacecraft here. For all the right mass reasons, we put the battery board with the heavy rechargeable batteries in the center of the satellite, and everything else kind of goes around it with the, I guess it's the radio parts that end up sort of out at the extremes because that's where the antenna connections are. You'll notice also that there are a couple of connectors kind of hidden in the center of the stack here. I want to show you a sort of mock-up of what the outside will look like. What that's all about should make sense. But the interesting thing is that in that stack, not one, not two, but four of those circuit boards fall into the this space for rent, available for science experiments, and so forth. We really are not even going to need as much as, you know, two-thirds of the volume of the spacecraft to build the satellite that we want to build. There are several different approaches that people have taken to doing the mechanical structure for CubeSats. The approach that Bob and the team are working on for Fox-1 is this kind of a bent sheet metal exterior structure with the printed circuit board stack in between, and you notice there's a bunch of holes in various places that, you know, take fasteners that tie into machine blocks that are in the stack. This ends up being an incredibly robust design, and it sort of minimizes the amount of mass and volume that's consumed by a mechanical structure. Seems pretty cute to me. And this is sort of what we expect it to look like when it's done. As I mentioned, you can see a couple of connectors sticking out the side between the solar panels on at least one of the faces. Those are the ground support interfaces and how you charge the batteries before flight and how you can talk to the processor and, you know, give it one last flash of firmware if you need to and make sure its health and welfare are all okay before you let them shove it into the pea pod and kind of kiss it goodbye for the last time. So that's kind of what all of this is going to end up looking like. As I mentioned, as we go forward, there are actually a whole bunch of different grant programs available now, primarily targeting university teams that want to build interesting satellites and launch them as CubeSats. We have now found, I don't know how Tony does it, but he's juggling several of these sort of grant proposal things in parallel and working with a number of different university teams that have interesting science payloads that they would like to integrate with our communications bus and fly. And so right now we have a couple of different proposals that are out. We've lost a couple of them. As I mentioned, we did win a spot in the NASA ALANA program, which will allow us to launch the first satellite sometime, hopefully in the second half of 2013. There's also a team from Auburn, University of Alabama, and AMSAT collaboratively with a proposal up for a National Science Foundation grant. I don't believe we've heard anything back on that proposal yet. We don't know actually exactly when we're supposed to hear back, but hopefully that'll be before too long. That, as it says, that was submitted back in May. And the interesting thing is this proposal is actually for two separate CubeSats as part of the science that the universities want to do. So guess what? You know, for us, that would be two more cool ham communication satellites in orbit, hopefully providing lots and lots of interesting capabilities. And we'll just have to wait and see. It's kind of exciting to me, and it was certainly exciting to Tony as well, that some of the university participants who were allowed to sit in on our preliminary design review a few months ago, apparently came away very impressed with the approach that we were taking, not only to the design of the various subsystems, but the way we were thinking about integrating the overall spacecraft and the general project and program management that was being applied. I have to admit that as a sort of deeply geeky, techie guy who's been around AMSAT, made my first personal contribution during the original Microsat series, Oscar 16, 17, 18, 19, and then, you know, got deeply, deeply embedded in Oscar 40. Can't tell you how many thousands of hours of my life went into that project. And I'm stoked, of course, that all the things that I worked on actually worked right in orbit, which is just immensely gratifying. I have to admit that after having been gone for a while, when Tony called and said, hey, you know, I've seen this stuff that you and Keith are doing with high-powered rocket avionics. Any chance we could, you know, con you into coming back and doing some fun stuff for AMSAT on this Fox program? I've been sort of startled by the amount of process overhead I get to deal with these days. It isn't quite as bad as I'm told the real aerospace industry is, but it's actually a whole lot more organized and a whole lot more structured, maybe a little more formal or something, than was the case in some of our earlier AMSAT programs. And I think the real difference is that that's the environment that we're living in today. If you want to put grant proposals together, and if you want to convince people that you actually know what you're doing and you're worthy of their paying for you to launch your cool toys, then you have to sort of have all the right processes in place to be able to convince them that you actually know what you're doing. And so I'm thrilled that we have folks in AMSAT North America today who think working on that stuff is great, because I don't. But you know, there are a number of different grant proposals out there and things that we're pursuing, and I hope that over time, you know, there'll be more than one of these that we actually win and that we end up with, you know, over time. It would be wonderful if we had a steady stream of one or two launch opportunities a year coming as a result of very aggressively working this set of launch opportunities with various universities. There's been a lot of discussion, particularly recently, on some of the AMSAT mailing lists about, you know, how, you know, is it really a good thing or a bad thing that there are all these, you know, university teams putting things up using ham radio frequencies and maybe not, you know, providing a whole lot of actual ham interaction capabilities with the satellites. This is the best way I can think of to change that. You know, if these become AMSAT satellites that we're partnering with universities to fly their interesting experiments on, they get all the same experiences for their students that they want to have. The kids can design stuff. They can actually build and deliver real circuit boards that get put into the stack and become part of, you know, real operating spacecraft. They can have all of that, you know, experience dealing with the integration and launch process, the early turn on and early data collection after launch on orbit and all of those sorts of things. It's a much lower risk, in, frankly, for universities, as I've already mentioned, to couple their scientific payloads with something that we hope over time will become a much more proven communications bus. At the end of the day, as I said, I think this works out really well for everybody. And as far as I can see, it's really the only chance we have, in the near term at least, for having the opportunity to continue building and launching actual amateur radio satellites that'll be meaningful for all of us to use. So, you know, look, AMSAT, as Tom Clark used to like to say, is an equal opportunity exploiter. If there's anything that you find intriguing or exciting about this, and you've got some skills and or time that you'd like to contribute, please contact Tony, our VP of Engineering, AA2TX, just AA2TX at AMSAT.org, or feel free to talk to me or John or other folks from AMSAT who are working on the Fox program who are around this weekend, and we'll be happy to try and figure out how to rope you in. The only thing I'll caution you about is another thing that Tom used to be very, you know, explicit about explaining, and that is that what AMSAT really needs are people that are committed. And of course, the difference between involved and committed is kind of like the difference between the pig and the chicken when it comes to breakfast, right? The chicken was involved, the pig was committed. So far, to the best of my knowledge, we haven't actually killed anybody who was working on amateur satellite, but it certainly can feel like you're getting close to the edge sometimes, particularly when we're on a tight deadline. But honestly, there's all kinds of things that we could use more help with, and if any of you find this exciting or intriguing, please feel free to let us know, and we will definitely find something for you to work on. With that, I thank you very much. If there's any time, I'd be happy to take a question or three, but I don't know where we are relative to time.
You're good
on time. Wow, I'm good on time. How unusual and exciting.
So you mentioned that the launch cost was out of your budget. What is it?
You know, I don't actually know. There are other folks in the room who probably do. Bob, do you know offhand what a CubeSat costs these days?
I don't know. No, it was always supposed to be $50,000.
Yeah.
And that was a decade ago, and I don't know.
My guess is it's somewhere in the order of $100,000 these days to actually get one of these things launched, but do you have a better number? Okay, depending on the orbit, 70 to 150,000. And of course, the problem is that, you know, we actually care what the orbit is that we go to. We would love to have an orbit that's better for, you know, ham communications than some of the really low orbits. And as a consequence, not every launch opportunity would excite us. I mean, on some level, if the only things that were available were kind of lame orbits, you know, we'd probably launch satellites into kind of lame orbits. But it does look like through the ALANA program and some of these other opportunities that there are just enough launches with P-pods on them going to interesting orbits that if we're willing to you know, play our cards right and kind of hold our breath from time to time, we might actually be able to get, you know, more interesting orbits. Got another question back here? Yeah, somebody's got a microphone. So.
Have you defined the pinout on the bus that goes between your circuit boards?
Yes, it's a crazy huge document, actually. The bus is quite well defined, and frankly, it's not a lot like a bus in the sense of, you know, PCI bus or something like that. It really is much more like a wiring harness in that it's got a gazillion pins, and a lot of them are sort of dedicated point-to-point connections between boards. It's just that by running them all through a common connector like this, we don't have the mass and complexity associated with a physical wiring harness. We don't have to carve out an area at the end of the satellite to run a physical wiring harness. And we can mix and match where things go in the stack, you know, to meet various other requirements like thermal balancing or, you know, connector placement and things like that. And, you know, if pin 37 is always, you know, mosey on spy 2 or whatever it happens to be, the thing that's supposed to be speaking on that and the thing that's supposed to be listening on that can sort of be anywhere in that stack and communicate. But it is very well defined. One of the things I'll tell you, on the IHU board, the version of the processor chip I chose is the highest pin count version. It actually has enough pins available that for all of the pins in that stacking connector that are not defined for Fox-1, I've connected some pin of the processor to them through a unloaded, you know, resistor physical location. So we could build additional copies of that circuit board and populate, you know, zero ohm resistors in all the places we wanted to, and actually sort of have lots of extra GPIO or analog or whatever IO available to talk to future experiment boards or things that we haven't imagined yet. So the stacking connector, it's one of those funny things. These connectors only come in certain granularities. When you realize you need more than a certain number of pins, you jump to the next series. The next series, smallest part, has a lot more pins than we really needed. Maybe not a lot more, but has enough more pins that there's actually some available undefined pins that could be used for future things. So I think it's kind of neat. It's not quite as cool as, you know, sort of having CAN bus or something running up and down the spacecraft. I know, wash my mouth out with soap for saying CAN bus, but as the guy who defined the protocol that we used, that was exciting. As the guy who defined the protocol that we were going to use on Eagle and P3E for CAN, I'd, you know, love to reuse that IP somewhere, but it's unlikely to happen. Other questions?
Just a quick question. Antennas. Your drawings didn't show what your antenna deployment mechanism is going to look like.
There's actually quite a bit of work ongoing on that. I'm not in a position to give you a good answer. John, do you guys have any better thought on sort of what the current state of the antennas are, or should we just leave that one on the floor for now?
The antennas for both 2 meters and 440 are quarter wave whips off the off of opposite sides of the satellite. No, I think that it's just a single whip off of each side.
I think they're just single whips. And I know that we have, there are solid state relays associated with providing current to burn through burn wires to allow those to be deployed after release from the P-pod, because they're on the IHU, but I don't know a whole lot more about it. I have to tell you, it's actually kind of fun. I mean, for a change, I'm not doing software on this satellite. I'm actually the guy designing the processor board hardware. There's a whole team, Bill Reed and a whole team of people are all lined up to do software. I've offered them all of our GPL'd, you know, stuff that Keith and I have written for our high-powered rocketry stuff, and so far I gather they're going to use approximately zero of it. So, you know, whatever makes them happy, yeah.
With a little bit of luck, what kind of lifetime do you expect out of Fox 1?
That's a really good question. I could tell you what the design lifetime is, but, you know, honestly, the transponder part ought to last, you know, nominally forever. It's you know, in an AO7-ish kind of way, you know, the basic RF parts should last a really long time. The processor, good question. I would love it if we got a year on orbit out of this chip. And whether that'll really happen or not, we just don't know. We're going to try and do all the right things to shield it appropriately and do all that stuff. But at the end of the day, we're talking about a 32-bit processor with fairly significant internal cache structure and, you know, on-chip flash and RAM, none of which has explicit error detection and correction. I keep hoping that, you know, Intel and all the ARM foundries will finally get to the point where they push the core voltages low enough that they are forced to do internal error detection and correction stuff, even for terrestrial systems. They seem to keep skirting just shy of that a little bit. I have to tell you that as the voltages have gone down, the probability of doing things like creating SCRs in the base structure and having, you know, latch-up events is much lower than it used to be. There just isn't as much energy floating around on the parts to, you know, energize those things as there used to be. On the other hand, the geometry of the elements is a whole lot smaller than it used to be. And so the probability of single event upsets is, if anything, higher than on some of the previous generations of parts. we're very, very carefully avoiding any parts that have things like onboard charge pumps and all that kind of stuff. But anytime you talk about any modern microcontrollers that we would actually find it interesting to write code for and or fly, they have things like programmable clock circuitry and so forth. And that stuff seems to be plenty robust, but at the end of the day, there are so many unknowns that, you know, honestly, if we get a few weeks of operation long enough to get some good data out of the MEMS gyros and declare the science experiment a success, if that's all we get out of the SciHU, then I will breathe a sigh of relief and say, I'm so glad we designed this thing so it'll run even when that's dead. But, I would love for it to run, to have everything work for some number of years. But realistically, personally, if we get a year out of the processor, I'll be excited. And, 5 or 10 years out of the rest of the bus certainly seems completely plausible. Maybe a whole lot longer. We'll just have to see. There's an awful lot of unknowns here. But that's kind of what makes it exciting. In addition to this notion of taking what we used to put in a 9-inch cube and squeezing it down into a 4-inch cube, and before that, you know, how excited we were to get into a 9-inch cube, what people have been putting in bigger things. So, Phil. I'm sorry?
Expected orbit lifetime.
Depends on which orbit we go to. I hate to be vague about that, but we don't actually know which launch we're going to be on yet, so I don't know. That's one of those ask Tony and hopefully, you know, as they negotiate which launch we're part of, we'll start to know more about that. And we're out of time. So thank you very much. I will be here, you know, all the way through until lunchtime on Sunday. If you have other questions or just want to talk about this more, please feel free to come by and grab me. Thanks very much.
All right. I think we're up to date. Well, we'll check in on the AMSAT Fox-1 satellite progress as we get a little bit closer to the launch date. Pretty excited about that. So for those of you that stuck around to the end, either you're interested in both satellites and preppers, or maybe you just zipped on down the timeline because you're the prepper kind of person, let's talk about episode 104 just a little bit. Turned out to be very popular. It's only been online for a short time. Let's take a look at the view count. Again, on the air for 24 hours or less, I think. On Blip, 648 views. It's getting there, building up pretty well. I'm still working on getting Blip and YouTube to talk to each other. I think I've solved the problem, but for some reason, this episode failed in transferring from Blip to YouTube, so I had to put it up separately. So it's been up a little bit less, and 150 views. So it's getting there in terms of hitting that magic 1,000 view count, and I expect this one to go well beyond that. Part of the reason was, well, taking a look at the reaction on QRZ.com, and by the way, bless QRZ.com, my method for getting most of my information to the widest number of people. Lots of people have looked at the thread or the article that I put up on QRZ.com. And there have been a lot of comments on it. Usually I get, you know, maybe two or three comments. Some of the more interesting topics get a few more. So this one is really starting to build up. And some of the comments that I kind of expected here. More nuts out of the jar. Get your day glow vest. Your weird hat. Aluminum foil. Several HTs on your belt. Hey, I wear several HTs on my belt. Aliens could be landing. Oh, you QRZ.com people, you. What am I going to do with you? This guy clearly did not watch the episode because we addressed all those things in the episode. He was just taking his pot shot the easy way by just looking at the announcement on QRZ. probably didn't even go to my website where I talked about those extreme elements. But the Prepper deal is very popular out there, as you're aware. But even the radio part of the Prepper movement has a lot of awareness. Just doing a little bit of searching, this website came up. And they're talking about what ham radio and the Prepper movement can mean to each other. And I got pointed to this website, which is for ham radio and preppers. Not just ham radio, but maybe primarily, or at least significantly ham radio and preppers. And they got turned on to my episode. Somebody mistakenly called the QRZ announcement an EHAM forum announcement, but it was on QRZ. Don't think it showed up on EHAM. In fact, they'll refer back to it. And they got some good comments, too. This first one just showed up. Might be fun to watch. Certainly fun to comment on. Sums up a lot. And they talked about me. I like these comments about me. On, you know, as if you know, I'm just some guy out there doing television. I kept looking for the interviewee to jump up and, I think he means dope slap, the guy. Meaning me. That was pretty patronizing. Yes, the interviewer seems overly attached to the comfort he derives from government chains. It was a very slow interview, but because of the subject matter, it's worth a watch. And people complain when I go too fast, and people complain when I go too slow. Anyway, I just wanted to make a few comments about that. The Prepper Show was a lot of fun to do, and we'll probably revisit that topic on a future episode, because it's not going away. It's only going to get bigger. All right, let's wrap this up. That's it for this episode of Ham Radio Now. I didn't even intend to make this one until I got some email from Tim reminding me that I hadn't gone looking for the missing episode. So that's all done. And I've got that, I mentioned with Jeff, the colonoscopy coming up on Friday. Today is Wednesday. Wednesday night. It's coming up on Friday. So I'm going to be kind of busy for the next couple of days. And I've got a bunch of other paperwork to get taken care of. So we will start cranking out a few more episodes of Ham Radio Now before we get to the 2013 Digital Communications Conference next week. So I will see you then. For that, for now, that's it. I'm Gary Pierce, KN4AQ. Over and very much out.